What is it that makes Homo sapiens unique? How can we, in contrast to the animal world, live in sophisticated civilizations, develop unthinkably powerful technology, and deeply ponder challenging questions about the nature of reality? There are many reasons why we humans demonstrate an immense behavioral complexity, but one reason is our unique syntactical language. The term syntax refers to the set of rules which governs how words convey meaning. For instance, the order of the words in a sentence determines the role of each word in that sentence. I eat the cake designates I as the subject and cake as the object. Syntax enables language to communicate an infinite number of ideas and give precise details about anything. We can even modify our sentences to ask questions, which enables us to extract specific information from other people. While language itself is not unique, syntactical language appears to be something fairly unique to humans, and if syntax does exist in other species, which could be the case in animals such as dolphins and elephants, it likely evolved independently from us. We don't often think about how unusual our language is compared to the communication systems employed in the natural world, as we can specify information to an astonishing degree. Or as the historian Yuval Noah Harari remarks, we can connect a limited number of sounds and signs to produce an infinite number of sentences, each with a distinct meaning. We can thereby ingest, store, and communicate a prodigious amount of information about the surrounding world. Language enables our minds to probe abstract ideas like morality, justice, and time. It is easy to take this for granted, since we are so immersed in a world where abstract notions form the basis of culture. But all of this is relatively new in terms of the history of our species. With language comes the ability to gather and recite tribal knowledge and mythology. As well as being a tool for communication, language has an immense impact upon our mentality and how we perceive the world. Our field of perception includes a lexical field, whereby our minds are able to categorize the various features of the world according to language, which implies that as language became more sophisticated, it resulted in profound changes in mentality. A person who has never learned a language would perceive the world in a fundamentally different way than a person who knows a language, and two people who speak different languages may perceive the world in totally distinct ways. One amazing example of this is that children who are good at naming colors are better able to remember them and recognize them. Language also affects our ability to concentrate on details, as having a name for an object changes our attention towards it. We even utilize language as a tool for thinking, and just try to imagine having complicated thoughts without having a syntactical language. So how exactly did language develop from simple calls and gestures employed by primates to the amazingly sophisticated system of sounds and rules which we utilize in the modern world? In a paper titled The Evolution of Language in the Late Pleistocene, Julian Jaynes argues that syntax first started to develop around 70,000 years ago, but it did not suddenly appear on the scene. Rather, language slowly grew to encompass more terminology, as people invented more and more words to describe the natural world. This evolution was an adaptation to the changing climate of this period, which forced humans to move into new and unfamiliar habitats. As he writes, "For any trait that is as universal in a species, and that has as precise a neurological substrate as language in man, must have developed during an age when it had a great and persisting survival value." Jaynes additionally argues that syntax is such a monumental change in human psychology and behavior that this change will be reflected in the fossil record of migrations, as well as archaeological evidence. Words are of such huge moment in the life of men that the acquisition of them and the ability to organize them into sentences that convey meaning must have resulted in very real behavioral changes, and these changes must be reflected in the artifacts left behind. We should note that this theory is somewhat speculative and not without flaws. The only real way to confirm it would be with a time machine. However, this rough guideline may serve as a starting point for further inquiry into the origins of language, and much of Jaynes's theory can be correlated with archaeological findings which strengthen this case, making it one of the best hypotheses which we have about the origins of language. There is also strong genetic evidence which we will discuss later on, which suggests that Jaynes's theory was on the right track. Jaynes points to the glaciation period beginning around 70,000 years ago during which Earth's climate became colder and glaciers grew and retreated numerous times. This period in human history saw massive migrations as we moved from Africa into Asia, Oceania, Europe, and even North America. Language may have enabled us to develop knowledge and insights faster, which allowed humans to expand into new territory to which they were not genetically adapted. This is also when human innovation exploded, as we invented boats, bows and arrows, flint-tipped spears, and fishing nets. And Jaynes believes that language was the mechanism which allowed for these impressive innovations. Before this theory, it was assumed that our form of language was much older than this, perhaps evolving millions of years ago. However, genetic analysis has revealed that the genes needed for abstract thought only appeared in our species around 70,000 years ago. This gene mutation occurred at the FOXP2 gene, a gene that is present in many species which is essential for communication. Humans possess a unique variant of this gene, which significantly expanded our cognitive capabilities. The appearance of new ways of thinking and communicating between 70,000 and 30,000 years ago constitutes the cognitive revolution. The most commonly believed theory argues that accidental genetic mutations change the inner wiring of the brains of sapiens, enabling them to think in unprecedented ways and to communicate using an altogether new type of language. This change also enabled us to cooperate effectively in large groups and coordinate our actions. Of course, just because this gene appeared at this time doesn't mean that language sprung fully formed as a result. Language also needed to undergo considerable developments, and Jaynes attempts to trace this development from simple primitive gestures and sounds to fully syntactical speech. We should note that the various stages presented are not necessarily discrete from each other, and these stages aren't necessarily meant to be exact, as different groups of humans may develop language at different rates depending on their social needs. The first change that needs to occur is the change from incidental calls to intentional calls. Incidental signals convey information indirectly, and aren't meant to convey information to a specific individual. When a deer calls in response to detecting a predator, it does this more or less automatically, and this is a genetic response which evolved as a survival strategy for the herd. However, a deer may do this even if there are no other deer around, meaning that this call isn't an intentional signal meant to convey information specifically to other deer. Primate threat postures, on the other hand, are intentional, since the goal is to communicate directly with another primate, with the specific intention of changing that animal's behavior. It is intentional because the aggressor may stop with their aggressive signaling once the other animal backs down from the confrontation. Aggression in dogs is the same, because once the other dog changes its behavior, the signaling ceases. Most primates use visual signals for intentional communication, and sounds such as screeches or grunts for incidental communication. But humans may have begun to use their voices for intentional calls, which is the first step in the transformation towards syntax. Jaynes suggests that humans may have begun to use vocalizations for intentional rather than incidental communication as they moved into more northern climates, as visual signals would be less effective in a darker environment. The next development is that of modifiers. Modifiers differentiate words depending on context, and most primitive modifiers were probably simple differences in intensity. For example, an immediate threat might result in a loud call, while a distant threat might result in a quieter call. This sounds simple, but this is how words first began to carry specific meanings, as one call means near and the other one means far. This had to occur before the invention of nouns, since it is of immediate survival value to indicate the threat level than to indicate the kind of threat. As an example, wahi could indicate a nearby lion, while wahoo indicates a distant lion. E and u become the modifiers, since they help to specify information. Note that nouns still don't exist at this stage, but it is worth noting that some primate species do actually have modifiers which indicate the kind of threat. For instance, some monkeys use a different call for eagles than they do for leopards, and an entirely different call for snakes. Once these ending modifiers become stable, they can be separated from the calls they modify and become commands. Commands are sounds which can modify actions, and this development allowed us to cooperate more flexibly. Just think about the psychological effect of having commands, as a person's behavior can be modified through the words he or she uses. The endings e and u, for instance, could be used to change a person's behavior, instructing them to go nearer or farther. A modifier, which means sharper, could result in the invention of better tools for hunting, as man moved into the territories of large megafauna. From this point, nouns become used to further specify information. As Jaynes writes, "Once a tribe has a repertoire of modifiers and commands, the necessity of keeping the integrity of the old primitive cries can be relaxed for the first time, so that they can indicate the reference of the modifiers or commands. Thus, from the original wa to wa-i, we might have waki for an approaching tiger, or wabi for an approaching bear. And these would be the first sentences with a noun subject and a predicative modifier. This is the beginning of syntax, and through a long process, language can become more and more descriptive, and this development continues even to this day. This is a monumental development which may have put our species on the path to civilization. These are called life nouns, since they are names for living things. The invention of nouns probably corresponded to the first time humans began making cave paintings of animals, as the invention of names for these animals is also the invention of the idea of these animals, and so it becomes possible to reproduce these ideas in a different setting. Language itself was probably responsible for the growing behavioral complexity of primitive humans, as at this point in human history is when human innovation exploded, and different forms of cultural expression and religion began to emerge. Once animals, particularly those that were hunted, had nouns that could designate them, they had an extra kind of being, one indeed that could be taken far back into the caves and drawn upon its walls. And from this time on, the first animal silhouettes develop into well-known cave paintings of bison and reindeer, which I suggest could only occur after the beginning of life nouns. Thing nouns are simply words to describe objects, and this development is important for inventing and creating new technology, as having words for objects like spears or pottery indicates their importance for survival. Just as life nouns began animal drawings, so nouns for things beget new things. The invention of pottery, of pendants and ornaments, bone carvings, harpoons, and most important, the invention of the barb for harpoons and spearheads. Jaynes believes that this invention corresponds to the Magdalenian culture, when humans became increasingly artistic. The next highly significant invention is that of names. Having verbal names for individual people is something unique to humans, and yet this idea is probably relatively recent. And it is incredible when you think about the fact that for most of human history, people probably didn't have names. This corresponds to the first ceremonial burials for people, and Jaynes explains why this is the case. Once a tribe member has a proper name, he can in a sense be recreated in his absence, thought about. While rare, individual, ceremonial graves date from much earlier. This is the first age in which they become common and elaborate. But just as a noun for an animal makes that relationship a much more intense one, so too does a name. And when a person dies, the name still goes on, and hence the relationship as in life, and hence an elaboration of burial practices and mourning. We should note again that these stages aren't meant to be exact or discrete, but instead represent a rough guideline, which allows us to trace the development of syntactical language. The pressure of glaciation, starting 70,000 years ago, may have forced humans to adopt new behavioral strategies, and language emerged as a consequence. There are also other selective pressures, which may have contributed to the evolution of language. Human infants are very helpless at birth, since our larger brains make it more difficult for women to give birth. As a result, human infants are born before they are fully developed, making them more dependent on their mothers. Communication between mother and infant is thus of the utmost importance, and this may have led to the evolution of children, who could quickly learn to speak. Children also benefit from language, as it helps to direct their behavior, and allows the parents to guide them and teach them important skills, something which is critical for group cooperation. The ability to speak also probably altered social behavior and hierarchical organization. Tribe members who could speak and give instructions well would be better leaders, and this would also lead to better group organization, increasing human group sizes, and enabling wider collaboration. It is amazing to think that the emergence of the modern world, with all of its complexity, was a matter of mere chance 70,000 years ago, with an accidental gene mutation. Language is a powerful tool, which we don't often appreciate, since it seems so common, but this is probably a very recent acquisition. Language has been instrumental in allowing cultures to form and expand. It allows societies to form laws and for philosophers to debate the natural world, as new insights lead to new innovations. Language also modifies our behavior, as a persistent mental commentary is ever present to instruct our actions. While the origins of language are still unclear, Julian Jaynes' model is a good start for further inquiry into this fascinating topic.